Okay, so hello everyone. This is Chinmay from the buoyancy team, and I also have Dr. Nagesh from buoyancy team. And today's guest speaker is Mr. Hemant SM from Bosch India, and he's the head of business for AIRO, which is artificial intelligence company within Bosch, incubated within Bosch. And today, Mr. Hemant is going to share his insights on AI product development and how the industry is looking at AI for future and immediate trends. So thank you, Hemant, for joining us today and taking time to share your expertise and insights with our Buoyancy Innovation Challenge participants. So over to you.
Thanks, Hemant.
And that was a challenge.
Okay.
Okay. Let's quickly start off because we've already lost time. Yeah. So let me put it this way: what is AI? Yeah. If we ask what is meant by AI, AI is basically a short form for artificial intelligence. And a lot of people have a question on why is AI required? How is AI beneficial? And what constitutes AI? Yeah, there are questions like, typical questions like, what is the difference between AI and ML, basically artificial intelligence and machine learning? There is a difference between why is AI required? Is AI very instrumental in, let's say, taking away jobs? So these are some of the questions which come with AI. Yeah. So in this regard, let me put it this way. AI is basically something which can aid a human being by doing certain calculations through a processor, through a system, thereby enhancing the probability of taking a decision in a much predictable or in a much known manner. Yeah, because AI always works with data, previous data, and there is a requirement of a lot of data coming in, feeding to the AI engine, which will in turn lead to AI engine becoming more and more better. Let me take a quick example of how AI is helping us in our daily lives. We are working on a product called Eero. Basically, Eero brings in a personalization engine into a retail segment. And if you ask as a use case, where does retail segment come in having AI? We have lot of data of purchases in a retail segment. We have data from CRM, we have data from loyalty points, we have data from credit card history. All these data are till today was not being used much. And with AI, with machine learning coming into picture, these data are today put to good use, where we can learn about what is the purchase history or what is the purchasing behavior of a consumer. And based on that, we can actually give a very predictable, very targeted and recommendation which is used as well as which can add value to the consumer. So I'm having trouble showing the slide for this one, but we'll try to do that. This is one of the key aspects of AI, where looking at, let's say you go to a hypermarket for shopping, and one person is a very quick shopper, while another person is a person who takes a long time to shop, but shops once in 3 months. So how do you individually target these people is pattern is through a pattern, and this pattern is learned through machine learning. And based on machine learning, there are certain actions taken and analytics, and this leads to artificial intelligence giving better recommendations to people. So another example of AI, if I can actually bring in to start with, is when you're traveling in a car, yeah, you actually listen to certain music. If it's a weekday, the kind of music which you learn is different. I mean, which you listen to is different. If it's different, while going to office, it is different. While coming to office, it is different. So all these patterns are learned through the machine learning engine. And based on certain contexts, like your office going time, your coming back time, the time where you are able to, let's say, listen to songs which are soft, the time where you listen which are melodious and instrumental, are all different. And these are things which are learned by an AI engine. And then based on that, when the person actually sits in the car, when you go and sit in the car, the engine automatically recommends you a playlist without you having to browse the things. So this is the beauty of AI, where slowly the your infotainment system, the car, the app of a shopkeeper starts acting like your personal assistant. And this personal assistant is powered by AI, and slowly, while in the beginning, this is, let's say, 2%, 3% of your persona, slowly, if with the kind of data being actually learned, with the right data being learned, it can slowly become a digital twin. Yeah. So a digital twin of a person is possible through AI, but what happens here is this becomes a personal entity, which means that the data privacy regulations and laws govern to ensure that this AI engine really caters to your needs and not just, let's say, needs of Google or Facebook or any other big player. And so here I would probably, I don't know, Nagesh, is there a option to take questions, or is it a one-way? Nagesh, you're on mute.
Yeah, it's up to you. So if you want to have questions now or whatever, so we can have a, not an issue. It is a meeting, so we can allow people to speak. They have to unmute and speak.
I think we can have a quick question break so that we are able to, Anyone, any quick questions? Okay.
Anybody with any questions at this point of time to him?
Okay. Okay. So I'll probably now that we have done a couple of use cases, what I would like to do is, because your topic is AI in healthcare, I would also like to give an example of how AI is being used in a healthcare scenario. So a couple of days back in the newspapers, there was one article which talked about how old ECGs were actually being used, the data from old ECGs were being used to analyze and predict a heart attack, possibility of a heart attack. Yeah. How is this possible? So what they did was they took ECGs of people who had false attacks and ECGs of people which were normal. And these were fed in through an engine which actually went through the process, did a deep learning. And then based on AI, it could actually did a training and a test and a training setup. So based on the ECGs and the true cases, the positives and the negatives, it was able to analyze and actually decide or predict in a fair manner that if the ECG has this pattern, then it's sure that this person will get a heart attack. Yeah. There's also, I mean, this was done. This is not a concept. This is done. Similarly, the startup called Niramai, which works on using AI to predict or detect breast cancer. Yeah, so different patterns across are taken, and based on infrared mapping, and based on this, they are able to, based on the large number of data, the deep learning as well as the prediction, successfully actually predict that there could be an incidence of, as well as AI, which could be put to use. Finally, why is AI required? AI is quite important because as a human being, we are not exposed to a lot of data. Each person, whether it be a doctor, whether it is a lawyer, whether it's an engineer. So we are not exposed to a lot of data as an individual person. Even if we have data, we are not able to, by ourselves, go through the pattern and give a depiction. That is where AI comes in, where we use the help of a very high-speed processing, as well as large number of data, which can be computed very quickly in a very fast manner through the latest processing machines on the cloud. And based that can be attributed finally to an individual aspect, where if I say I'm a person who has a high BP, they can actually look out on the cloud and see for a person with high BP and this ACG, what could be the probability of incidence of a heart attack. Yeah, so that is something which is possible today. And that is where AI or artificial intelligence is adding value. And coming to what is the difference between a machine learning and an artificial intelligence? Machine learning is a method where you are able to actually take the data and do some learning of the data based on certain contexts. It could be a continuous learning. It could be based on event trigger, or it could be based on a context trigger. Basically, we are looking at event trigger being things like, let's say, if there is, do this if there's rain. Yeah, play me this music if there are rains. This is an event. If continuously track me and let me know what path I generally use in a retail store, it's a continuous path tracking. So the engine starts learning as soon as I enter a store, a retail store, and tracks me through the entire path. And this is an example of a continuous learning. And when I go out of the store, it stops learning. So then there could be, from a healthcare perspective, event-based trigger could be if the BP, based on a wearable, if the BP actually rises above this particular, heartbeat rises above this particular instance, then trigger a emergency call. This could be a trigger-based different in a healthcare perspective. So based on this, what happens is the machine learning, in, while it keeps learning on a defined set of contexts or a rule, it then sends the data to the engine, to another engine, which makes sense out of it. So this is your analytics engine. So let's say, what does an analytics engine do? Is it analyzes what is a pattern, yeah, and it gives a report on a dashboard. But then the next intelligent analytics is something which brings out an insight from this particular analytics, and it gives a feedback to the machine learning engine. A typical example is, let's say, when you're shopping, you get certain offers, recommendations and offers. And if you actually accept the offer, or if you look at the offer for a long time and make that purchase, there's a feedback to the machine learning engine that this kind of recommendations is really good for this person. Whereas, let's say you talk about a private label offer, a spa offering, a spa branded item, and you say, I don't like it. Then it tries it another time and the third time. After the third time, the insight engine actually learns, or the context engine actually learns, that this particular person may not like this. So in order not to be an irritant, let us not give this again, or let us wait for a cool off period. So this is what is done by the insights engine. Yeah. So so this is how the machine learning component, the analytics component, and the insights component actually work in tandem together in a circular fashion to bring sense into a recommendation, into an insight from a, which is got from a engine, AI engine, and then it leads to a scenario where you are able to appreciate, you are able to give value to the consumer or the user to make it, to use it in a better fashion. So this is one of the things. So AI in autonomous car, for example, there's a continuous learning of certain obstacles, which is fed back into a knowledge base. And this knowledge base is also, again, the other cars need not go through that scenario again. They just extract the definition of an object or an obstacle from the overall bigger knowledge base, and it will jumpstart the vehicle into identifying certain things. Yeah, let's say in US they do detect certain, or in Australia they do detect kangaroo, but in US there's no kangaroo, right? So, but still this detected object can actually be mapped and put into a bigger knowledge base and tagged, we call it tagged as a kangaroo. So that tomorrow, if there's any US-based car which comes in, which is using, a US car being driven in Australia, it actually taps to this database and it can right away recognize, okay, there's a kangaroo head, let me stop. Yeah, similarly with respect to, the other best example is, your speedboards, the road traffic signs. Road traffic signs do vary, and the meaning of a road traffic sign is different across different regions. Yeah, in US you do have the stop scenario, which is not available, in India. So the stop signs are not used well. So when you're driving in US, you have a particular app which gives these insights. The camera looks at the stop sign and it right away gives you an indication that, okay, a stop sign means you need to stop, give the right of the way to the person coming from the right side. And then once a person leaves, you can leave. So these are all today possible as an educator, as a listen, right, without the person even being aware completely of these things, there's an aided training possible due to artificial intelligence, right? So from this perspective, if you ask what would be the scenario from what we know, on artificial intelligence taking over certain things and people not getting enough jobs, people are being removed out of the jobs. A recent survey, which is also published, says that due to artificial intelligence,
Looks like we lost a few minutes. In between. So,
So I was talking about the ISRO launching Vikram.
Okay.
And what is happening here is because of this, there's a dimensional shift of manual work changing to a skilled work based on certain skills related to computing, to machine learning, to analyzing data. So these things are becoming more critical. Yeah. So that is how there's a dimension change in the aspect of engineering, where engineers today are more looking at how to manage and how to analyze the data. Hello? Any questions now?
The participants for the innovation challenge, do you have any questions at this point of time? So you can unmute and speak.
Nagesh, I missed if there were any questions.
There's a question he is saying. He's asking, please suggest various tools to develop AI product.
Sorry, is an alternate?
This question from Ramesh is, please suggest various tools to develop AI product.
Okay, for AI, machine learning, there are multiple tools. One, typically Python and R are used which are very predominantly used. But in the new age, there are also very specific tools which come predefined filters and or predefined preset libraries as well, which are coming up today. So if you go to, let's say, Amazon as well, AWS, Amazon IoT has a lot of UI which makes it use their let's say offerings and develop AI based software. Similarly, if you go to Google Labs, Google has a lot of options use even for using TensorFlow. You can actually go into Google and say, how can I use TensorFlow? How can I use Google camera analytics software? These are all today, each of these big chains, in order to ensure to promote their software being used, do provide a lot of access to AI, which are, UI and tools, which are very easy to use, which are like a drag and drop, plug and play UIs. What you would need to know, though, is if you want to start from a base, Python is a good tool to use. Python is a good coding software platform to use.
Just to add on to this, Hemant, I think every big players, including IBM, Microsoft, have their some kind of a developer versions of most of these tools available. So that's what probably the students can check out.
Correct.
And explore. Maybe based on the environment they have and access they can get and all. Most of them have the developer versions which the students can suddenly make use of for their learning and development of prototypes and all.
Correct.
Okay, thanks Amesh for this question.
Any other? Do you think there's a new need to develop new laws regarding development process of AI? So if you look at AI for autonomous, for things which are dependent on life, there are definitely regulations and laws which are coming up. We saw the cases in Tesla where one of the case was a truck which was going in front, took a turn, and the autonomous car going behind actually could see the truck till then, but when it took a turn, the sunlight blinding, the sunlight which was actually reflecting on the side of the truck, which was in fact metal, brought a dash of light, which the camera felt that it was an open space, and there was a person walking in front of it, and the car actually went ahead. So these are some of the things where regulations play an important role. But can we build up regulations upfront? I would say no. There are certain regulations which keep coming in as and when the maturity of the topic continues. So as the topic becomes more and more mature, they learn more and more, and it can be added on to the regulations. But definitely there is a need for governance and even if not laws, at least guidelines for AI. But if you look at things like GDPR, so GDPR may not be directly AI-based, but the data privacy regulation. So Europe has released the GDPR, General Data Privacy Regulation, in around May, June this year, which is very stringent on how do you use personal data. Yeah. So earlier, though data was there, people were not using it left and right. But right now, because of machine learning AI, people are trying to access all data of an individual, whether or not he or she likes it or not. That is where laws related to privacy, laws related to security are coming in, and this will continue.
So I saw some two teams had raised their hands. Do you have any questions now? Yeah.
So one more.
Yeah, just
okay.
Read out the
Nagesh,
question.
You want to take it?
No, I'll just read out the question so we can probably collectively answer that. So, you know, sir, the question from Ramesh to Ramesh is, can you suggest course forum where we can learn AI? And I'll just start and we can add more if you have anything more. So I think Coursera had a bunch of courses around, and there are a couple of forums also which are talking about that. But I think Coursera is a good detailed course covering this AI significantly. One of these. And of course, there are for a short learning, there are some even the tutorial forums. I mean, the tutorial point and all have a bunch of short tutorials, but they may not be going deeper. But I think Coursera is a audiovisual one which runs into a couple of hours. So you can register and go forward. Anything you want to add, Ramesh?
Yeah. Coursera has good certification courses. And it is led by a renowned person, and I would definitely propose, like Nakesh said, for you to undertake certain courses from basic, and if you want to go into advanced, all kinds of courses are available. Yeah. So apart from that, today all the major universities, including Stanford, Emeritus, MIT are all offering courses on AI and digital business through online channels. So you could have a look at it. There are quite a few interesting ones also which come at the end of it with a certification. So if you feel that you want to go more deeper into it, you could do it. Or if you're looking at actual, let's say, residential courses, IASC provides it on AI machine learning, as well as a lot of universities are there providing such courses. But for online, I would suggest either Coursera or Stanford or even MIT and Emeritus. These are the four which I would suggest.
Okay. So what Ramesh is asking is, okay, I think let me just try to put it and you can add more to have MIT, Stanford.
Oh, you're typing
it. Yeah, I typed it, yes. So, I think you added one more.
Emeritus, E-M-E-R-I-T-U-S.
Oh, yes, yes, let me put it.
It's a Singapore-based one, which is currently started by MIT and Columbia University. Upskilled as engineers, if you have not been exposed to machine learning, AI, then I would suggest that you actually take these courses to be aware of it before you finish your engineering, because most of the organizations are moving towards this, and especially the startups. If you look at, if you want to be with the startups, a knowledge of it and hands-on projects in these areas would definitely help you to get in onto a new age or a high-tech career. So the heart attack was actually in the newspaper again. It was in Economic Times. I think it was on Friday, last Friday. I would need to get it, but if I get it, I can actually send it across to Nagesh, maybe.
Yeah.
If he has the main idea, he can.
Yes. We'll share those details.
I mean, I can actually send the presentation as well from use cases as well as these for you to probably go through it in order to get a better understanding.
Yeah, I think, Hemant, that would be a good suggestion. So you can share some of the resources and other materials to us. Then we will forward to them for their
Sure.
Thank you.
So unfortunately, I had a problem connecting on my laptop, and that's why I'm not able to share. So I'm actually not connected.
That's fine. That is fine. I think those materials can be shared offline. So I think that's a good. Yeah, I think yeah. It is more the interactive session is more useful. I think just for your information, I think we have about close to 50 teams which are working on this our innovation challenge at this point of time. So I think I'm not sure whether all of them could join at this point of time in the session. So that's where I was seeing a couple of teams.
Yeah. So what I would, I mean, from an innovation perspective, thanks for bringing it up. One suggestion is basically always look at it from a customer perspective. Yeah, I would like to, let's say, bring it on the Lean Startup. So there's a book called Lean Startup also, and a book called 0 to 1, which are very important ones to read. To learn how to go from innovation to a business in a very quick and methodical manner. Yeah. So what is important is when you're innovating, to look at what is the problem statement that you're wanting to solve. Yeah. So while high-tech is, book name is 0 to 1 and Lean Startup. While it is important for us to develop high-tech software, many a times only high-tech software does not help. Yeah. So we would need to know what is the customer problem. Institute problem, and from that we need to take in, okay, this is the problem I wish, and if you have data, what should I use to really look at certain patterns and make sense of the data to be able to address their consumers. Yeah, it need not be only say in the area where you say I have to help find a solution to a disease. It could be a simple thing like what a hospital has. How can I ensure that the persons checking in are not spending a lot of time? How can I ensure that there's a very good person is being navigated to the right place, that they're not getting lost? Yeah, so these, by, let's say, having minimal number of people, how can I bring in AI? How can I bring in machine learning? How can I learn things? How can I use the digital aspects to serve the businesses better? So this would definitely help in taking the innovation into a successful business. So three key things for any business is basically, how can I optimize costs? How can I improve the revenues? And how can I have an increased customer experience? So if we are able to address one of these three, then the solution is definitely viable to be bought by a business. So some inputs on innovation, because we started off as innovation 2.5 years ago, and then today we are actually catering to top few major chains in retail as well as mobility, and now we are getting into hospitality, and that has been possible mainly because of the fact that we are more looking at it from a customer problem to resolution, and rather than building a platform and trying to sell. For AI, there's a very interesting audiobook in Audible. I was really very fascinated about it. It's called 21 Lessons from the 21st Century. Yeah. So this in the chapters 3, 4, and 5, it is exactly talking about the person there talks about the use cases of AI in modern day world, and thereon they also talk about the risks of AI. How should governance for AI be there? So if you have a chance to go through Audible, Audible has also has a 1 month free subscription where one book can be, let's say, downloaded for free. So I would suggest you to just install the app, download this book, and then if you don't want to continue paying a subscription after before 1 month, just uninstall, cancel the subscription. So this book is really worth it. Otherwise, it is available for something around 600 rupees if you're already on Audible. But I would still suggest to go through this book. 21 lessons from the 21st century. So this basically focuses on AI and use of AI, the risks of AI, the governance required, whatever questions came up now is very well covered. It's an 11-hour audio book with 21 chapters. Yeah. Okay. Please read through, please go through what is happening in the world. Important aspect also is to look at who are the major players in AI, not only the big companies, also startup companies. Browse through the net on AI in healthcare. You would get a lot of startups working. You could get a lot of inputs and pointers from what are the cases being solved and how successful they have been. The key point also being what are the KPIs to measure an AI output. So it's not just important to find out something, how successful it is, how closer are we getting to start with a set of raw data, and as the data is learned more and more, it becomes more predictive. So it becomes more, let's say, accurate in predictions. And this is a stage where machine learning or AI takes over and starts giving predictions to humans. Yeah. So I think from my side, this was the thing. So I'm also open for any other questions. I would share certain use cases and slides and. Okay, I covered it as a part, but quickly, machine learning is a method where you start collecting data and learn about the context and the preferences. Yeah. So deep learning is where you have a lot of set of data. Millions of certain data available where you're able to learn and build a pattern. For example, Google's deep learning example was on feeding a huge set of photos of cat, and when Google Lens focused on the cat, it should be able to predict at any angle that it's a cat. So that is deep learning, where the data required for deep learning is very huge. For machine learning can be at an individual level or can be at an enterprise level. Yeah. And all these put together, when you look at analytics, build insights, and then provide, let's say, recommendation or provide, perform an action, that is AI, that is artificial intelligence. The whole concept of machine learning to analytics to insights, all put together constitute the AI part. Hope that question was answered.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. Any other questions? Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Hemant, for your
thank you so much.
And,
thanks, and sorry for the technical inconvenience.
okay. So that's okay. I think we are. We're going to go for most of the period. I think it's for the initial hiccup. I think mostly done. Not an issue. Thanks for your, I think in spite of this busy schedule, Hemant had found a time to address all the students. I think that's a good applause from our side. So thanks, Hemant, from buoyancy and also from the students who are participating in the session.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Students.
All the best to the teams.
Sorry? We could not hear you.
All the best to the teams.
Oh, thank you. Thanks. I think students, I think we are having best wishes from Hemant for your next steps. Okay. Before we close, I wanted to have a few remarks for the students. One aspect is, I think as most of you are aware, you people have to submit your documents with a 1 minute video on your product that you are finalizing before 23rd so that we can get to the next steps. So that is one key steps that you have to complete. If you have any queries about the template or any details to be submitted and all, you can reach out to us either through mail or phone, whatever the contacts are already available to you. Unless if you have any questions, then we can take it up. Otherwise, we can close this meeting. Anything else?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks again, Hemant.
Thank you, then.
Thank you. So we'll
have a good day.
Thank you.